So welcome to another aspect of upper limb examination of the arterial system. With me is Dr. Jayati Churiwala, consultant at Sir JJ Group of Hospitals, and I'm Dr. Jignesh Gandhi, a unit head at KM Hospital. And today we are going to talk about how does one go about inspecting an upper limb system. So grossly, how does one go about the standard of care always remains the same, as we know that you have to introduce yourself to the patient, wash your hands, don a PPP if it is adequately required. Once you have done that and adequately exposed the part, what are the inspective findings in an acute patient versus a chronic patient, which will give you some hint about the arterial system compromise?
In a patient who presents with acute upper limb ischemia, the patient will complain of severe pain in the upper limb, which may be associated with the limb turning cold. The patient will be unable to move his fingers, so therefore there may be paresthesias or altered sensations in the limb. So that is how we will be able to differentiate acute limb ischemia versus chronic limb ischemia, in which the patients may present with features of intermittent claudication, that is pain while using the limb for doing their daily activities.
Okay.
On examination of these patients, it is important to look for certain specific signs which might give you an idea of A, your diagnosis towards limb ischemia, and B, the cause of the ischemia.
Okay.
In terms of acute limb ischemia, we may see signs such as cyanosis or bluish discoloration of the digits, especially also in a phenomenon called Raynaud's phenomenon or Raynaud's syndrome. The patient might give you a characteristic history of change in color of the tips of the fingers after exposure to cold environment, from white to blue to red.
Okay.
What we may also see in terms of chronic limb ischemia is thinning out of the skin, loss of hair, transverse ridges over the nails, which are characteristic. You may also see wasting of the muscles, especially of the thenar and the hypothenar eminence.
Okay.
What we may also see in terms of the cause of the ischemia is A, tobacco staining, which will characteristically present around the nails. What we may also see is a dancing brachial pulse, which is characteristic of atherosclerotic disease, sir.
Okay, so a lot of clues which you can get up, you know, a simple examination like seeing a tar staining on the upper limbs, or maybe some xanthotomata, which would tell us that the patient has got high cholesterol, will probably tell us in how to go about that. So once you have done your inspective findings and differentiate between acute and chronic, how do you go about with the palpation of the peripheral pulsation? So again, is there any pattern which you would like to follow?
Sir, we usually go from distal to proximal, starting with the radial and the ulnar arteries at the wrist, the brachial artery at the elbow, the axillary artery, as well as the subclavian artery.
Okay, so to begin with, it's always a good idea. What I feel is that you should start and see for the capillary refilling time, because that is one of the indicator which tells us that what is happening. So if you look at here, you know, this is a patient where, you know, you have to press this for about 4 to 5 seconds, and you can see a blanching which is happening, and the moment I release after 5 seconds, you can see that now it has become completely red. So this tells us that the capillary refilling in this particular area is very good. How about palpation of the radial artery?
So to add to the point of capillary refill time, it might take up to 2 to 3 seconds for the capillaries to refill even in normal individuals.
Okay.
So a CRT of more than 3 seconds is significant in terms of peripheral vascular
That's
disease.
A very good valid point. And pulsations, palpation, how do you
going about the palpation of the pulsations in the upper limb? We begin with palpating the radial artery, for which we position the upper limb like this. So what we do is
put the patient in a semi-prone position, and then you try to sight the dorsiflex so that you can get your 3 fingers rightly into that area.
Correct, sir. Characteristically, it is a position in which we shake the hand of the patient.
Okay.
In which we semi-flex at the wrist and semi-pronate.
Okay.
And then palpate the radial artery against the lower end of the radius using 3 fingers. The
So what is the significance of those 3 fingers?
So that using 3 fingers, other than palpation of the presence of the pulse, what we are also trying to look for is the force, the tension and the volume of the pulse. What we're also looking at is the rhythm and the regularity of the pulse, along with measuring the pulse rate for a minute.
What about the brachial artery?
For the brachial artery, we slightly flex at the elbow, make the tendon of the biceps brachii prominent, and just medial to the tendon of the biceps brachii, we can palpate the brachial artery.
So it's an important landmark, that you have to identify the landmark. So here you can see that you have identified the landmark of the tendon, and then you just go a little bit medial to that and you put your fingers there, and then you will find it. that you are feeling for the pulsations. It's also important to know that sometimes you have to feel for whether there's any thickening of the vessel. So in that case, what you do is you feel for the brachial artery, you feel for the radial artery. The moment you feel the both the pulsations, you compress on the brachial artery, and then you see to it that the force ceases here completely and there is no blood circulating into that. And then when you roll your finger onto the radial artery, you can feel for the vessel wall thickness. Are there any conditions where they will be thickened to begin with?
Sir, arteriosclerosis is the pathology where the vessel wall is thickened due to deposition of fat.
So elderly patients and even calcific, you know, so if you have a calcific vessels, it will be thickened with that. Coming up to the upper part, how do you go about palpating the axillary artery?
For palpating the axilla, you have to abduct the upper limb at the shoulder. Use your three fingers to insinuate into the axilla and try and feel the axillary artery against the neck of the humerus.
Okay, fine. So this is where you will be going into the axilla, and as rightly shown here, that this is the way you will be examined. And what about the pulsations above that?
So above that, we try and palpate for the subclavian artery in the supraclavicular fossa. We go right above the clavicle and try and palpate the subclavian artery against the first rib.
Okay. So this is where you will be completing that, and if you see some patients where you're going to also find for the carotid pulsations to complete that part, is you will be making the tendon of the sternocleidomastoid more prominent, and usually it is palpated at the upper one third of the sternocleidomastoid, and the landmark is that you just feel it against the upper one third at the level of the upper border of the thyroid cartilage. A lot of times the students have a habit that I will be palpating against the Stechnax tubercle, but let me tell you that in clinical practice it's very difficult to identify the tubercle per se. It's always a good habit that you palpate at the upper end of the thyroid cartilage, identify the upper end of the thyroid cartilage, feel the medial border of the sternocleidomastoid and feel your pulsations against that. That's where you will be seeing for the carotid pulsations. So can you just summarize what all will be the findings you will be seeing right from the capillary feeling to upwards?
Yes, sir. One more thing I would like to add in terms of palpation of the carotid artery is remember that what you are palpating is the common carotid artery and not the external or the internal carotid artery there. That is one brownie point you will earn in your examinations.
And second thing is that one should never palpate both of them at the same time. Otherwise, you can put this patient into vasovagal syncope. So, can we summarize from below upwards, from the capillary refilling upwards, what do you do?
From below upwards, you start with checking the capillary refill time, where you press on the nail bed of the patient, look for the blanching for about 5 seconds. On releasing it, you will see a refilling in the form of erythema in the nail bed, and this should appear within 3 seconds to suggest an adequate blood supply. This is followed by checking the radial as well as the ulnar arteries, the radial against the lower border of the radius over the wrist, and the ulnar artery over against the lower border of the ulna again at the wrist in a characteristic hand shaking position. The brachial artery is palpated with the elbow flexed slightly, exactly medial to the tendon of the biceps brachii. Next, we check for the axillary artery pulsation by slightly abducting at the shoulder. We palpate the axillary artery against the neck of the humerus. Next, we check the subclavian artery, which is palpated in the supraclavicular fossa against the first rib. And we palpate for the common carotid artery against the
at the level of the upper border
of the thyroid cartilage, just medial to the sternocleidomastoid.
So, any importance of temperature in the examination of the upper limb?
Yes, sir. In peripheral vascular disease, checking the temperature of the affected limb and comparing it to the normal side is extremely important, because in peripheral vascular disease, the affected limb is relatively cold compared to the normal limb. So, it is very essential to start by first checking the temperature on the unaffected limb. Once you have palpated the unaffected limb, you come over to the affected limb and compare the temperature on both the sides. Especially in this COVID era where we are always wearing gloves to examine patients, it is very important to remove your gloves to check the temperature and compare it against the normal side.
So the sequence is very important, as you rightly mentioned. Go to the unaffected side first. And this is an area which is a dorsum which has got sensitive receptors. We never palpate it with the palmar aspect. So palpate the unaffected first, and then when you go back to the affected part, you can appreciate the difference very clearly, and then you can say that this particular limb is ischemic. I think that's a very valid important point when you see for the temperature in upper limb examination. So this summarizes the complete examination of the upper limb arterial system. dividing into the acute and chronic changes, identifying that, and small things like identifying of the tar staining or the xanthomatter. This can give you special marks in the exams, because identifying them gives you a particular diagnosis towards the etiopathogenesis of the problem. And then, as rightly she has mentioned about all the points from top downwards, just follow a pattern whether you want to go below upwards or above downwards, but in the lower limb it's always better to go from below upwards, and then identifying all the landmarks. Thank you very much, and we should always thank our patient at the end of this session, because this is what helps us to gain more confidence, and this is a good gesture also for the examiners that you have thanked your patient before completing the clinical examination. Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Jayathi.
Thank you, sir.